2010 at Liberty Forum in New Hampshire, hosted by the Free State Project, Stefan Molyneux was invited to speak. However, instead of coming up with a prepared speech, he did something a little different. He set out to test his new argument against a room full of people who would be receptive to it, and to see if they could poke holes in his new idea. Now, Molyneux has, for some time before this, been pushing hard for an idea called pointing out the gun in the room, meaning that whenever someone advocates the need for a centralized state with a monopoly on the legitimate use of initiatory force, he would point out the violence inherent in the system.
Come and see the violence inherent in the system! Help! Help! I'm being repressed!
The argument goes like this. Let's say that you're arguing with someone who supports a government policy, any government policy. Let's say the border wall, which is a nice ironic touch. It goes like this. Person 1. Do you support the border wall? Person 2. Yes, I do. 1. Okay, fine. You should be allowed to agree with that, and I would never use force against you for that opinion. I would never throw you in a cage for saying such a thing. Do you extend that same level of respect for me? 2. Sure, I'd never. 1. Great. Now, it would make no sense if I just supported it without being able to act on that disagreement, correct? 2. Okay. 1. Okay, so you can go ahead and pay for your wall, and you should be able to go and take out your checkbook and help pay for that wall. 2. Okay. 1. Now, because we agreed that it's just an illusionatory right to just be able to disagree with something but not able to act on it, do you support the use of force against me to throw me in a cage or have me shot if I resist paying for that wall?
Ladies and gentlemen, we got him.
Now, the point of this argument is to convince the person that what they are advocating isn't just violence in the abstract, but aggression against you personally, and forcing them to agree that they want you personally hurt for supporting your pet state policy, and to get away from any kind of consequentialist or utilitarian arguments, and just focus on his brand of ethics. It is to, as Molyneux states, put them on the defensive. Now, there's a few things wrong with this, but let me clarify some things. I do agree that the state is bad, and that they rely on violence and the threat of violence to achieve their goals, and it is not preferable to me. However, this is a very terrible way of explaining this idea. First, let's start with optics. If you are trying to convince someone of a concept, it's probably a bad idea to point out flaws in their personality, to accuse them of being violent or malicious, to paint them as a bloodthirsty person who wants to see dead babies and elderly people on the side of the road. Let me draw this parallel, which I have made in a satirical video, which I will post in the description box below. So you want to abolish Social Security. Does Social Security give money to people to live who otherwise couldn't afford basic needs? Do you understand that without those basic needs, they could starve to death? My grandmother is on Social Security. Why do you want my dear Meemaw to starve? Now, we can get into the specifics of why a free market that would not be the case and that there would be charities, but again, this point of the argument was to get away from any kind of consequentialist or utilitarian arguments, but to force them to understand that their policies will result in people getting harmed, which is unjustified in their flavor of ethics, and to put you on the defensive. As anyone who has ever argued against welfare programs with people who support them, they have probably experienced this sort of argument before. And you know these types of arguments are not very persuasive, just as any kind of arguments that are designed to paint you as a bad moral agent.
And so what is that reason? And almost all the time when you hear something like, I'm offended, well, it's a desire for someone to control you, the desire to put you on the defensive and for them to have power over you because they don't like what you said or something like that. But so what? You don't like what I said. Come to me and discuss it, but the mere fact that you're offended, fuck you. Fuck you, I don't care, right? And this is why I actually hate the argument, the against me argument, because that's exactly the same thing. Is that I'm offended you do that against me. You do that against me, right? That's it's just this bullshit intimidation, right? Because anyone could do that against me. Oh, you're going to take welfare away from my baby? Oh, I hate that sort of stuff. So getting offended to me is just, it's this bullshit way to bully people. And people that like using these sort of bullying tactics and sort of bullying tactics like the against me argument, I don't like it. I can't stand it, and I always have a desire to control them back, to take the power back, to rip the power back away from them.
The argument itself, free speech. Now, beyond the point that these arguments are not very persuasive, they just fail. One of the most important points Molyneux brings up is that you are pulling on the levers of things that people already agree with, like the freedom of speech. The problem is, most people don't have this opinion when you break it down into specifics. Overall, most people in the United States think that free speech is a great idea. But when you ask them specifics about if people should have the right to hold certain opinions, not so much. Should people have the ability to say whatever they want? Sure. Should people have the right to say racist, sexist, homophobic, et al. Opinions? That support starts to sharply decline. The further you get, the further you get out of the United States, it declines even sharper. Sure, you can ask someone, do you believe in free speech in the U.S. and elsewhere? There's a good chance someone would say, absolutely. But the odds are less in your favor if you ask them questions like, do people have the right to doubt if the Holocaust existed on a public forum? Or do you think that people should be able to use the N-word to describe black people? The argument itself, part two, logic. In the argument, Molyneux explains that in order for someone to have the right to disagree, they should also have the right to act upon that disagreement. Now, at first glance, it sounds great, but once you think about it, it's pretty bad. Well, let's take, for example, I disagree with the wall. Should I be free to oppose it, not just verbally, but also act upon it, voting for people who also oppose it, advocating for taxes that would pay for it, etc.? Well, sure, that's what he would say. But what if we explore some other rules? Should I be able to violently oppose it by shooting people who are attempting to build the wall or destroy it once it's built? A lot of people would start to disagree with it at that point. How about this? Should I be able to disagree with the laws of gravity? Sure, why not? Flat earthers do it all the time. But should I be able to act upon the disagreement and float? How about this? Do I have the right to agree that all white people should not exist? Well, sure, it's a terrible opinion, but I guess you can. But do you have the right to act upon that disagreement by slaughtering them all? Not so much. How about this? Should I be able to disagree with the non-aggression principle? Sure. Should I have the right to act upon that disagreement by punching everybody who advocates it? You could see why this doesn't work. The right to free speech can exist in a world where you cannot act upon those disagreements. I don't know why he assumes this. In conclusion, now using something like the against me argument may be useful if someone has a hard time understanding how the state utilizes violence to achieve all of its ends. Just make it very clear that you're not like ascribing malice to the person you're explaining it to, but you're just instead explaining a misunderstanding that they have of the nature of the beast. But as a way to convince people that the state is not great, like the against me argument, is clearly problematic. Now, I have reasons to believe why it was constructed, and it was for reasons other than convincing people that anarchism or voluntarism is a good thing, but I could save that to a later video if people are interested. But for now, I'll just leave it here. Thanks for watching, and hail Satan. Hey guys, what do you think of this new video format? Do you like it? Should I ditch it and go back to just a static picture? Let me know in the comments.